Okay, so how is everyone today? Good, I hope. So, as a reminder, I think the registrar has notified all of us now. The midterm is on May 23rd. Not May. That's not right. March 23rd. The midterm. The final exam is on May the 4th, which is terrific because when the final exam begins, I can say, May the 4th be with you. Please don't. Well, it might happen anyway. It's going to be hard to resist. Okay, so any questions about that? Okay. Last time we were talking about lines. We're still talking about lines.
So, specifically, last time, we had a remark, ended with a remark, that looked like this. We said that, well, lines can be broken into the following categories. Vertical lines is one of the categories. So, for example, this one. Here's such an example.
Now, I didn't draw any tick marks, and I'm not sharing my ruler with you, so you wouldn't be able to tell me the exact value of this.
But we could measure it and say that the equation is x is equal to a for some a.
And even though you don't have a ruler, so you couldn't tell me the value of a, you should still be able to tell me the SIGN of a. What is it? Positive. Must be positive, because it's on the right side of the origin. Okay? Similarly, we could have lines which are horizontal. Here's such an example.
So again, I'm not sharing my ruler, but we know that
such lines should be y is equal to some constant b. So because I'm not sharing my ruler with you, you wouldn't be able to tell me the exact value of b, but you should be able to tell me the SIGN of b. Y negative. I thought we constants were positive. Y negative. Because it's below. Good.
Similarly, and finally, we have lines that are neither one of these. Such lines are said to be sloped. And then we break the sloped category into two subcategories. Those that look like this. Those that look like this.
So specifically, we started making a calculation about what slope is. And then, we said that you can measure horizontally, take two different points on the line, measure horizontally, and measure vertically. So for example, if we were to select
this point and this point, on that line, then we can make the following horizontal measurement. Okay, so that little measurement right there. So when you're doing college algebra on the street, what's the name for the horizontal measurement? In street talk. Run, right? So this particular horizontal measurement, is it going to be a positive or a negative measurement? Positive, because we're moving to the right. And then from here, we could measure going down, going to the other point here. And what's the street name for this one? The rise. So is this particular rise positive or negative? Negative. Why is it negative?
Because it's
we're going down, right? In a sense, because these two arrows are pointing, these two right here, are pointing in opposite directions. So negative. And then, using the words run and rise, what is slope? Rise over run. So the ratio of a negative value over a positive value is negative. So the slope of lines that look like this is negative. Similarly, if we select two different points on this line and then make analogous measurements, this is the run. This particular run would be positive, and this is the rise. How about that rise, positive or negative? Positive. So this line has a slope, which is the ratio of two positive values, so its slope would be positive. Okay? Then, if we had rulers and we started making actual measurements, we could actually measure what the true slope is. Now, for backwards continuity, now we can talk about the slope of this one. What is the slope of a horizontal line?
Zero.
And in plain language, why should it be the case that the slope of a horizontal line is zero?
It's rise over run. And that makes it zero.
So, maybe I'll say it like this. Horizontal lines have zero rise. They're not going up or down. So the numerator's got to be zero. How about the slope of vertical lines?
It's the limit of wherever it's infinity.
Okay.
Or really, really tall. That's why we've got the tall.
Slope is tall?
it's a very high limit.
So the correct response is undefined. The slope is undefined. So, in as plain of language as possible, why should it be the case that the slope of a vertical line is undefined? Can't put it in the calculator. Well, why not?
Anything over zero is undefined.
Right. The run, in this case, the left to right movement, is zero. And if slope is rise divided by run, then for this one, to do that would be to divide by zero, which is undefined. So the slope is undefined. Any question about this page? So now the purpose of today is that this is a purely qualitative categorization of lines, a visual categorization of lines. And the purpose of today is for us to be able to, corresponding to these shapes, which is a visual thing, we should be able to have a purely calculation point of view. A calculation that can tell us all of these things without recourse to any shapes. Okay. So, to that end, here's a picture. We'll select two points. So how about this one and this one? So there's two points. Now I'm going to draw the line passing through them. That. Okay. So now, first question is that you should be able to tell me which one of these is right. So as for the slope, is it undefined, zero, negative, positive.
Positive. Okay. Any question about it being positive? So this would mean, this would be equivalent to asking, is it straight up and down? So it's not. This one, which is to say vertical, this one would be equivalent to asking, well, is it horizontal? It is not. And then, you know, these other two, obvious. Okay, now.
I could say, well, maybe I want you to compute the slope exactly. So what is the value of the slope?
Well, how can we go about addressing this question? Counting. Yeah, I like it. So
we'll start here, and then I can see that I need to move 1, 2, 3 to the right. So I move 3 to the right, which means that the run is how much? 3. Why not -3? Because we're going to the right. And then as for the rise, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So what does that tell us? The rise is 8. So the rise is 8. But wait a minute, why is it not -8? Because we were going up. Okay. So the slope value is 8/3.
Any question about this exercise?
Are you wanting us to simplify that any further?
No. I'm not sure what you mean, even. Do you mean like 6 2/3?
Right, yeah.
No, please don't.
Or have like a decimal or something.
If I ever want, so in the first place, I never expect to ask you to do that.
Okay.
In the second place, if that's what I wanted, I would be very clear to ask. So now, suppose that we have a line through the points -3, 1, and 5, -4. I could say find the slope.
Now, notably, in comparison to the previous exercise, I gave you a picture, and then I could ask question number 1 without recourse to any computation whatsoever. You should, given a picture, you should be able to tell me if the slope was undefined, 0, negative, or positive. Here, it's far less clear if the slope should be, you know, what case it should be. Far less clear. Okay, so how do we go about addressing this exercise?
You could draw it, right? You could actually draw it and then do a counting thing, right? You could get out some paper, actually plot it, just like I did, and then count. So suppose that you're not one for drawing.
It's still the ratio of y2 minus y1 over x2 minus x1.
Exactly. So the run, in this case, run is x2 minus x1, which in this specific exercise is 5 minus -3, which is 8. And the rise, y2 minus y1, is, wait a minute, yeah, -4 minus 1, which is -5.
Okay, any question about computing these values?
So then, that being the case, what is the slope?
-5/8.
Now,
statistics being what they are,
I'm quite I'd be willing to bet that at least one person in here wrote that the slope is 8 over negative 5. So why is that incorrect? What would that be, in a sense, 8 over negative 5? That would be run over rise. That's what that would be. Now, I have a theory as to why students might do this. So,
because I've observed students do this, and then ask them directly, using the words run and rise, what is slope? And they'll tell me, rise over run. They'll do it. But they'll report to me that the slope is the other way around. Well, because x comes before y, most students compute the x first, and then the y. And then vertically on the page, that means that you have this 8 over this negative 5. And then students report the slope to be that. 8 over negative 5. So I'm just bringing this point out just because I've seen so many students make this mistake. So any question about this? Okay. So, we want to be able to make the connection between any lines at all and their shapes and some algebra. So in order to do that, we're first going to take a smaller bite and say, suppose that we have a line with a defined slope. Which is to say that suppose we have a line that is not vertical. Any other kind will do. So now, just for the sake of a picture, I'm going to draw one that has a positive slope, but do understand that we're talking about any line that has a defined slope. Okay, so suppose that we have this line. And then suppose now we take the following measurements. We say, okay, well, I get out my ruler. I measure the coordinates of this point and determine those coordinates to be x1, y1 for some value of x1 and y1. And then suppose further that I select another point, any other point, xy, and then I measure
the run and the rise.
And without regard to what those actual values are, suppose that I just call this value m. Right? Maybe m is 5. In this particular picture, we know that m has to be positive. But I could take the picture and reflect it the other way, right? Like this. And then it would be negative. Okay? So that what I'm saying is that suppose we're given we now have these two pieces of data. We know that a point that is on our line is x1, y1. And we know that the slope of our line is m. Then it must be the case that for any other xy, I could slide this xy around and go way out here or down over here. It must be the case that y minus y1 divided by x minus x1, like so, is equal to m, wherever I put that xy. So now I'll multiply both sides by the denominator of the right-hand side. And now I'll switch the sides of the equation. stand here. Is an equation that you're expected to memorize from now on. What do you suppose is the name of this equation? The point-slope equation, or the point-slope formula. Why do you suppose it's called the point-slope formula? Because that's the data that we have, right? So,
that being said, I can give you the exercise. Find the equation of the line through one, two with slope three. So in this model, in this formula, there are three parameters which you need. You need x1, you need y1, and you need m. So in this exercise that we're doing, which is the easiest, the most straightforward application of this, what is x1, y1? One, two, right? And then what is M? Three. And I want you to solve for Y. Just to give you something to do, I suppose. So this would be Y minus, well, Y1 is 2. So Y minus 2 is 3 multiplied by X minus x1, which is 1, so minus 1. So that would be y minus 2 is 3x minus 3. So y is 3x minus 1. Any question about this? Now, if this was part 1 of this exercise, and in part 2, I said, here are two possibilities for the line. So two possibilities for the line.
Which one is the right, is the more reasonable? Which one is more reasonable, and what is the reason? Right. So, clearly this line has a positive slope, and this one a negative slope. And the line we're talking about has slope 3. So that one right there is the only reasonable one. Any question about this? Okay.
Alternatively,
I could say
there's 2 points.
There's the line passing through them.
And I could say Find the equation of this line. Solve for y.
Okay. So, the formula that we have, what's the name of the formula that we have? Point slope. Which, and in particular, it's not called the plot formula, right? And what we're given is a plot. So that means that from this plot, we need to extract a point and a slope, if we are to use the point slope formula. Okay. So how about a point? Okay.
-3, 2. Okay. I heard some other people say a different one. What other point is on this line? -4, -1. So that's another point that's on the line. And there's many others, right? We could get out the micrometer and start measuring. Okay. So it's called the point slope formula for a line. What else do we need? Slope. Okay. So let's calculate this. So this would be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So that's 7. So what's 7? What's this? The run, right? Okay, and then 1, 2, 3. So this means that the rise is 3.
So I'm waiting. -3, right? Why negative?
Because we're going down. Okay, now this is enough to proceed now. So the slope is straightforward enough. The slope is -3/7. The point
Well, now we heard someone call out -3, 2. 4, -1 is also on there. So which one are we supposed to use? You know, because we wouldn't want to use the wrong one. It doesn't matter. It can't matter. That's what we talked about on Wednesday. As you move the two points anywhere, any two distinct points on a line that's not vertical, the slope has to be the same. It doesn't matter. So if you have some other criteria, then you can use that criteria. It doesn't matter which one you use. You know, maybe you've got something against force, and that would incline you to use the other one. Okay, but I'm going to use the 4. I'm going to use that one.
So I'll use 4, 1, 4, -1. But the other one would work just the same. So the equation is y - y1 = x - x1. So then y - -1 is -3/7 x - 4. So y + 1 is -3/7 x + 12/7. So y is -3/7 x + 12/7 - 1.
But 1 is 7/7, so if we have 12/7 and we subtract 7/7,
then what remains is 5/7.
Any question about this exercise? Okay. So, now,
a little bit of just jargon. And that is that in this picture of a line that has slope, so for example this one, you select two points, this one and this one, and if you move to the right, this measurement is frequently referred to as the run. And this one, the rise.
Now, the further along you go in mathematics, the less these terms are used, run and rise. Rather, you use the terms
delta x and delta y. Okay, now a little bit of commentary is useful. Delta x is the run, so its formula is x2 minus x1. And delta y is the rise, so its formula is y2 minus y1. Now that symbol, I agree entirely that it looks like a triangle. It's not. It's a letter. It's delta. So delta is a letter, but it's not in our alphabet. Our alphabet eventually derives from Latin. We inherited the Latin alphabet from the Romans. The delta is from the Greek alphabet. Different alphabet. Nevertheless, just like ours, their letters, you know, they spell out their words with letters, and the letters have individual sounds, and then they're composed into entire word sounds. What is the English letter that corresponds to Greek delta? D. Right? If you were reading a Greek word and it began with delta, then it would sound like an English word that began with D. So the reason for that is that this is the difference in the X's. So delta is for difference. Okay. Now, that being the case, slope is frequently written as delta y over delta x. So it's just yet another way to write these things down. And one of the things I want you to take away from this is that, you know, the deltas are not numbers. And in particular, you can't cancel them, right? Like if this was 3y over 3x, you could cancel the 3s. But the deltas, they don't cancel. Okay? Because it means y2 minus y1 over x2 minus x1. Okay. So, now, so for example, I could say, find the equation of the line through 3-1 and 8-9. So now, for me at least, in comparison to the visual version of this exercise, because these two exercises are conceptually identical, this is the visual version, this is the calculation version, it's easy to tell that the slope here should be negative. Less clear for this one, I think. So, if we want to find the, and I want you to solve for y, so solve for y. So the only way we know how to find an equation presently is with the point-slope form, which means that We need to compute a slope. And now I'm going to use our new terminology. I'll say that, well, delta x, which is frequently pronounced as the change in x, would be 8 minus 3, which is 5. And delta y is 9 minus 1, which is 8. So the slope is what? 8 over 5. So slope is 8 over 5. And then now, for the point, we have two options. Which one are we supposed to select? What do you think? Because again, we wouldn't want to select the wrong one. Either one, right? You can't make a wrong choice. So maybe there's some other reason to select one or over the other. Which one would you, maybe you have a preference, which one would you prefer? Yeah, I think 3-1 would be marginally easier, just because the numbers are smaller. So let's do it. So the equation. Y minus 1 is 8/5 times x minus 3. So y minus 1 is 8/5 x minus 24/5. So then y is 8/5 x minus 24/5 plus 1. Which is 5/5. So, -19/5. Any question about this? This is okay? Okay, so now, a slightly different version of line. So now, we're doing something that's just like this page, is that we're going to start out with a line, and then we're going to make measurements. Okay, so, and in particular, this is a line that does have slope. So suppose we start with a line, and this is the line that we have. Now, what I did before is I said I'm going to select any old point. Now I'm going to be much more specific in my selection. I'm going to say I'm going to choose the point where the line crosses the y-axis, which is to say this one. So such points have, because that's, remarkable, it's something you could notice. What is the name for such a point? Y-intercept. So suppose we get out the ruler and we measure this. Well, we measure its coordinates. Well, even without getting out the ruler, you know the value of one of the coordinates, even without the ruler. So which coordinate do you know, and what is its value? We know that the horizontal coordinate, the x1, should be 0. And then suppose we get out the ruler and we determine that the y is b. Now, even without the ruler, You should be able to tell me the SIGN of B. What is the SIGN of B?
negative for this specific example. But if I was to take this line and push it up, then eventually b would be positive. Okay, and similarly, suppose that we get out the ruler
and we measure a delta x and we measure a delta y and we determine that the slope is m.
So on this particular line, the slope is positive.
So what I'm telling you is that suppose that we have these two pieces of information. We have the y-intercept. We have that the y-intercept is 0b. And we have that the slope is m.
Well, the y-intercept, that's just a point, right? So really what we have, in a sense, is we have a point and a slope. So there's, in principle, nothing wrong with us using the point-slope formula.
So that's what I will do. So y minus y1 is mx minus x1. And as it happens, that is y minus b is m multiplied by x minus 0, which is y minus b is mx, which is y is mx plus b.
And this is a formula that, from here, you were expected to memorize. Y is mx plus b. What do you suppose is the name of this formula? Slope-intercept.
Because that's the data that we have.
Slope-intercept formula. Okay. Because I suppose that slope y-intercept formula, though more descriptive, is more complicated to say. I wish it were called the slope y-intercept formula, because that would dispel a lot of confusion for students.
Okay. Suppose that we do the following. So I say, find the equation of the line with y-intercept 0, comma, 0, comma, negative 3, and slope negative 2.
And I want you to solve for y. This is about as straightforward as it can get for this particular exercise. So in this slope-intercept formula, there's two parameters which you need. You need m and b. And in this specific exercise, what is m? Negative 2. And what is b? Negative 3. So y is negative 2x minus 3.
And if that was part 1, and in part 2 I gave you four options and said, here are four lines.
Of these four, which is the only reasonable choice? The bottom right. So, okay. Why are those two not acceptable? They both have positive slope, and the line that we're talking about has a negative slope. So those two are out. Why are those two not reasonable? Because the y-intercept for both of those is positive, and the one we're talking about has a negative y-intercept. So the only possible choice is this one. Any questions about that? Okay. Finally, we can connect all of these. So notably, for the last 30 minutes or so, we've been talking about lines which have a defined slope. And we've been neglecting the ones that have an undefined slope. So now we need to say, okay, now we're talking about all of them again. So, here we are. Every line is expressible as AX plus BY equal to C for constants A, B, and C with A and B not both zero. Okay. So now that's a pretty bold claim. So now we need to establish that this is in fact true.
So the first category on the first page of today is we said that there were vertical lines. So let's suppose that B is zero.
Now, because of the constraints that we put, if B is zero, what else must be true? A is not.
Must be the case that A is not zero. So that means that we have this term, but not that one. So that we have something of the form AX is equal to C. And now, because A is not zero, it is permissible to divide this equation by A so that we have X is C over A. And notably, because C and A are constants, C divided by A is also constant. So we have X is equal to a constant. And what are such things? They are vertical lines. For example, if C over A happened to be 3, then that might be what it would look like. Now, suppose that A is 0. Then what is the immediate consequence of that? That B isn't. Which means that we have that there is no AX, but there is a BY. So we have BY is C. And because B is non-zero, it is permissible to divide by B. So Y is C over B. And because C and B are constants, that means that C divided by B is also constant. And Y equal to a constant, what kind of thing is that? Horizontal line. The final possibility is to say that suppose neither one are zero, then that means that we have both of these terms, AX and BY. So then BY is negative AX plus C. And then if we divide both sides by b, then we have negative a over b x plus c over b. And what I want you to observe is that this equation is the equation of a line which is in slope-intercept form. Which is, and what I mean by that is that this is the slope, and this is the y-intercept. Which is to say, this situation looks like this. Interesting. So what I'm telling you is that these categories of undefined slope, zero slope, and non-zero slope, those are visual categories. And they are all, can be all associated to this equation. And this is the calculation point of view. This is the visual point of view. Calculation, visualization. Calculation, visualization. Okay, have a nice Friday.